All right, I'm gonna start off talking this week, unlike what we've been doing lately, because I wanted to kind of go over this engine bay really quick. You'll notice that the engine bay is all in a semi-gloss or matte finish paint. There is one other color that a friend of mine recommends using. It's a lacquer that he says is a really good match for Ford, and it's one from Krylon as well, and that's the Industrial 1613. That's a good match in the engine bay. If you're wanting to do something like this, where you're trying to make something look just like factory, and it's gonna give you what you need, and they call that a semi-flat. So there you go, engine bay's ready to go. Now, some of the stuff in here you'll see, we'll need to go in and kind of polish around on this area of the firewall a little bit to get that looking really, really nice, but that'll probably come in after we get the wiring set back in and get the engine back in the car. We'll start working on some of these details as well. But today, what we're gonna be talking about is NICOP, stainless, and steel lines. I'm gonna go over why each one of those has a space in the classic car community. Now, there are three different options you have when you're doing a classic car. One of those options is the standard steel lines that come on these cars from the factory. And when you're doing an aftermarket booster, you can use about, I don't know, 70-80% of that line kit. It's just the way it's gonna be. And then you have to get some more of that type of line and go in and do custom bend work to get up to the new combination valve you're gonna be doing for the disc brakes. The second version is a NICOP, or nickel copper brake line. Now, the nickel copper is what a lot of guys today are going to for simple use on cars like this. It aren't necessarily gonna be concourse cars or cars that are gonna be going out and doing a lot of show work. The NICOP works really well because it's easy to bend, very malleable, and with the NICOP, you don't have to worry about any kind of weep or pull on the fittings whenever you're putting this stuff together. Sometimes with some of the other ones, you can have some issues with it not quite wanting to seat on the nipple of whatever you're putting it to, and it can cause a problem for either an air leak in or a drip out. The third one is the one I like the most, but not the one we're going to be using on this car, and that is stainless steel. The stainless steel line is just very pretty. It really sets off an engine bay, especially on a classic Ford where you've got a semi-gloss black, then you've got a nice, bright, shiny silver line for your brake lines or any fuel lines that are in here, and it just looks very neat, very clean. The problems with stainless steel line are they're a little harder to get your double flare fittings that you put on these lines, and they're also a little harder to get to seat. A lot of times I've had problems with the stainless steel actually pulling air into the system because they're not seating on the nipple correctly or the flare, and you're getting an air seep but not a fluid leak. So you have to be very, very careful and very cognizant of how you set those lines up and how you install them. They're not quite as forgiving as the other two. So those are the three types, but today we're gonna start working on setting the line system back up in this car and getting everything run to the combination valve that I'm about to install along with the brake booster. All right, so the first thing you wanna do is you've got a bracket that you've gotten from the guys at National Parts Depot. You've got your booster from National Parts Depot, and you're gonna wanna try to get this bracket on here. Now you're gonna have to take the master cylinder loose. Now, this is all for fitting the brake lines. I'm not gonna do this for permanent because I want to actually take the master cylinder and paint it cast coat probably before I go in and start bleeding the brakes. So this will all be done and put back together and ready to go, and then we'll bleed the brakes from inside the car. I'm going to pull this up a little bit because the bracket does not fit with the master cylinder fully down. You have to pull it up a little bit. And I'm going to set it back on here. I'm going to move it a little bit to the driver's side because I don't want it contacting my vacuum port. And if I'm not careful, it will contact that vacuum port. I like this because it kind of puts everything together. It will, in some respects, kind of neaten up your engine bay a little bit. You can put the combination valve on the wall. You can put it on the bottom here. This just makes a little neater installation setup. All right, so what I'm going to show you right now is where we're at with this, because how I want to configure it myself, The line kit that we got in from National Parts Depot, the two different ones, do not line up with the fittings. So I went out and bought these Christmas fittings. Red and green. These fittings actually come in a little kit that you can get. I got these online off of Amazon. You can get them from there and it works great. They come with a bunch of different fittings. You might want to buy a couple of these to just keep around for whenever you're doing brake lines, because it will help you in order to be able to get what you need to put everything together. What we're going to do next is I'm going to show you kind of how I want to go in and configure this for an actual setup for brakes. And I'm going to be using Nycop for all of my work on this kind of stuff. Now I'm going to be using as many of the original lines as I can get away with, just simply because I don't want to deal with having to go in and bend everything to get from one side of the car to the other. The brake lines seem to be in good shape. The brakes were working great before. I'm not going to fix that if I don't need to, but I am changing this booster out. All right, so what I got is a little piece of coat hanger here. This is going to be my template for being able to bend my Nycop into the correct form that I want. These are actually not quite the right depth on our friendly master cylinder. They're a little too short. And they're about the right distance apart, but not quite. It needs to be a little longer. So I'm going to use this as my template to bend from, so to speak. I'm going to take this and just roll it over that edge, which is probably a little sharper than I'm going to want to go on this. And I'm going to go a little further out. Now I'm going to take it a bit, turn it over. And I'm pretty darn close to where I want to be for my template. And we know we want to make this one a little longer than the other side. And we don't want to come out a huge amount, probably about right there. That's not quite where I need it to be. I want to come in a little bit more. And that's what this is all about right here. Is setting it up as a template so that you can get your line bent to pretty much what you want it to be. So I'm going to take this and cut it off. Told you it'd fly. Probably ought to be wearing safety glasses doing this. I figure that's actually pretty darn good right there. Need to cut just a hair off of this one. Somewhere a picture window breaks. But I think we're going to be okay with that. So I'm going to take a little section of Nycop here. I'm going to start working it. And what I'm going to do with this is I will mark it up where my bends need to be. Oh, there's one. There's a Sharpie right next to Paul's wall. So I want to start my bend right about there. Into my bend right about there. Start. All right, I'm going to cut this off with my giant ancient pipe cutter. or copper line cutter. Now, NICOP, you do not have to use the tool I'm going to be showing you here in a second. I just don't have anything other than the Eastwood tool I bought ages ago to do this, because I mostly like working, like I said, in stainless, and it works the best for this. Nice little double flare. Always make sure that you put your fittings on there now, because quite frankly, you won't be able to put them on there after you're done with it. Okay, I'm gonna go to the other end. Make sure you got your pieces set in there correctly. Get that down first. Tighten it a little bit. Yeah, see, your line's not quite in there. You wanna take the line, push it out some, and then use the flat piece to make sure everything's lined in correctly. Then you're going to go to your 3/16, which is your brake line size, and you're going to make it bubble. Then you're going to go to the 3/16 bevel, and that's going to give you your double flare. And there you go. Theoretically, that should be fine. One of the hardest things I found to do with any of this kind of stuff, I don't know about NICOP, but if I'm dealing with standard steel line or stainless line especially, is bending these short, small bends. Trying to figure out a good way to show you guys what I'm trying to do here. Got a soft handle for a pair of pliers. And I'm just walking it around, trying to keep it round. Because one of the things that you can do sometimes with this stuff is you can bend it and you end up putting a kink in it. And I'm checking it every once in a while to see if it's starting to flatten out. Seems like we're doing pretty good so far. Using the rubber handle on a tool like this will help you to not kink the line. Because the NICOP is fairly pliable. Almost there. It does have some amount of give to it. Blow test. I'll never be a trumpet player, but it seemed to work okay. All right, now I think we're pretty good on that. That bend looks like it's going to be okay. It's going to be the tricky point because we may end up having a little bit of an angle to it. So there's guys out there that make this stuff look easy, and it is definitely an art form knowing how to bend this stuff and how to get the bends correct. Camera guy's not being quiet. Start a little below it. I'll change hands. Still working. Uh-oh, how did that happen? It's not a cup, so I can bend it. Learn something new every day is what Logan said. And I have just learned that I put that down on the bottom where I shouldn't have. And now my line's gonna be all messed up. Well, there's a lesson for everybody right there. Always make sure that the fitting is down by the point where it needs to be for final. A lot less painful for your thumbs when you do it with a tool. I'm a little short, so I'm gonna have to rework it. All right, so I'm gonna take my booster and put it in there for test fitting. And you notice I've got a pad here. This is to protect the engine bay now that we've got it refinished to a degree.
And this is why we test fit. We've run into a problem in here. I think I need one of these to hold it. But the problem I'm going to run into is with the low mount, the way we're doing it, it is going to run. We're going to run into the firewall again in a different spot. But I'm not going to do what Fabri-Kobble Incorporated did and, fix it by banging a hole in it. I could probably make this work, but I'm not liking it the way it's sitting right now. So it's got to come back out. I'm going to go back to the drawing board and refinish the spot on the shock tower. All right, now what I'm doing is general test fitting right now on this booster. I've taken the studs out of here and put the export brace in to make sure that we're going to have plenty of clearance around it to be able to get the lid off of the master cylinder itself to be able to check fluid levels. Everything is pseudo tight. I'm not going to say it's in the final resting position, but it did point out a problem that we probably should have checked first. And that is our combination valve mounted on the bottom going to work in the bolt hole configuration that came from the factory? And it's not. What I'm going to probably have to do is back it off more from where it's at to probably about right there to be able to make any of the corners that we got that we need to do. I really do want to mount the combination valve on the bottom of the master cylinder because it's the best place for it. When you're doing this sort of thing, you have to remember that you have hood hinges going in and those hood hinges collapse down into this area. With that being the case, you could possibly collide with your combination valve if you put this big honking disc brake combination valve over on the inner fender right over in here. Okay, so now I'm going to put my second line in. I've already rebent this one and put it in here for not final, but it's a final setting. I know it will work. I know it will bolt up at both ends, so I'm good to go on that. This one, what I'm doing is I'm taking and putting an existing piece of line. Now, that could be stainless line. It could be a standard mild steel line. It can also be the Nycop that we're using on this particular car. And I am going to use that as my starting point to know where I need to drop the other line. And I want to try to keep them roughly the same distance. And I know I'm probably not going to make that happen because I'm not real good at this sort of thing. I'm just marginal at best. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to mark this where it intersects the tube. I'm going to leave the NICOP in there. I'm going to bend this like I would my NICOP and see if we get a good line on it. And I'm going to have to start whittling on this piece here. In order to get them to play nicely with each other, I'm going to have to cut. This is why I say I'm not that good at this stuff. I have to take probably that much off, which is just a little shorter than, this is for the top, so it's a little shorter than the bottom, which is typical of what we've been doing so far because of positioning. Always wear your safety goggles. I didn't have mine on. Now I'm going to take this, put it in the fitting on the bottom, pull that out, put that in the fitting on the top. If I can run that and match it, I probably need to make it just a hair longer on the top. And then I should have a good fitting there where it'll be pretty darn close to where it is now. We're off by maybe an eighth of an inch. So I'll need to make it just a little bit longer. And you've seen me how I bend these things. You know how this works. I'm going to show you a little tech tip I learned when I was doing the other one on this side using my knot tool to bend these. Away we go. All right, so what I'm going to show you now is a bend technique that I kind of just came up with here in the shop. If you've got some of these type of small-handled cushioned pliers like this that have a nice thick cushion on them, this will work. You could probably also do something like this, like these pliers here, and a couple of shots of Plasti-Dip. These are available around. I've seen them out there on the market, so I know you can still get them. Because some of my stuff is 20 plus years old, I keep forgetting that sometimes they're not available anymore. What I'm doing is I'm taking this. You'll see my mark there on top of the line. I'm going to flip it over. That is the beginning of my bend, and I'm going to try to keep it so that this bends with that mark staying as flat as I can keep it. You have to be careful. And I do recommend a blow test, but that gives you a nice little bend there. Oh, and always keep your fitting between the line and the ferrule. If you don't, you'll have to start all over again. And no, you won't be able to reuse your line. So I can get that straightened out a little bit better. Still blows. All right, this top one is not wanting to start as well as I'd like for it to. Always pays to be ambidextrous when you're doing this sort of stuff. I don't ever completely start a fitting until I can get both of them to go. May have popped this one a little too short. I have to fudge that bottom possibly. First, I got to get it to it. And yes, this will be much easier on a bench. I'm going to start the bottom one first. get it roughly in there on the master cylinder. See if I can get that bottom one to crunk in there. When you're doing this stuff at home, it's always a lot harder than it looks on television, for sure. Undo that one just a little bit more. Give me a little bit of playroom. For the top. All right, they are both started. Both of those lines are in. It doesn't look too bad. I'm not a big fan of Nycop for the look, unless you want a real, you know, steampunk looking engine bay, but it works a treat for being able to do those kind of things. If you were trying to do what I just did by manhandling that in stainless, you would have some really sore hands by the time you were done, or you would need to use some kind of tool to be able to bend those into the right position to get them where you need them to be. Those are both in. Now I've got to go in and do the rest of the lines. I'm going to do one more tech tip and I'm going to sign it off here because I want you to see what I'm planning on doing with some of these other places within this system. I don't want to bend new lines for the rest of this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use something I'm fixing to show you. All right, so what I'm talking about is a junction block. Now this junction block is a really big honking thing. Yes, isn't it funny how on Amazon things always look smaller in the photographs and then when you get them there, or they look bigger in the photographs and then they show up and they're a big old honking thing like this. I'm not even sure this is going to bolt up to the existing lines. I do have factory original junction blocks. They're much smaller than this. In any case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use junction blocks to tie into the original line, and then I'm going to run my lines from, for instance, way back over here that you probably can't see. I'm going to run one from... I'll run a line from here to the port from on the front of the distribution block, aka control valve, and then I'm also going to run one from here to the passenger side brake line, and then I'm going to run the one that's over here. Let's see if I can feel it. The one that's on this side, I am going to run a line from it to a junction block to the brake line that goes in and out to the brake system on the car. And that's basically just using bending tools, whatever you find. Like I said, this kind of stuff right here is a boon for doing those tight bends like I just did. I don't know about any other brake line style, but with the Nycops, it works a treat. All right, so that's a little bit on how to bend your own brake line setups on these cars. It's not that hard. You guys can do this at home. Heck, if I can do it, you can do it, right? So do me a favor, be kind to each other, love on each other, treat each other nice. I'm hoping that'll apply in the comments, because I had a friend of mine look at the comments the other day and he said, man, this is brutal. I'm not sure I want to do YouTube. So you haven't had a guy tell you you need a toupee. And by the way, what's up with your elbows? Let it go, man. It's just words and they don't mean much except that they're nice. See, there's your key right there. You guys have a great week. I'll see you next time on Auto Resto Mod. I hate to keep saying this, but it's actually coming together. Really slowly, but it's coming together. Oh, by the way, I know some of you are like hot for Cam. But he had things to do today, like not to do with this. So if you're looking for Cam, I'm sorry, he's not here.